must be from different background, all might not be from the English background. So I just thought, how could I, talk about one author or one, speaker? And that was the time all of us, especially I'm a very sensitive and a human being. So with that COVID, effect, I was also a bit, affected. I was just thinking how we are going to handle all the things, the humanity is going to handle all those things. We were half, with that, pressure. But within that, pressure, then I started, thinking about the technology. How in this technological, world, we are so advanced with science and all. So how could we actually look now? Now it's time not to display, it's time to look inward. So that was the thing, which came to my mind. And I just thought, okay, let me browse the pages of the history and let me see how self has been, defined or being, taken during the different, eras, during the different, periods, during the different times, of basically I'm focusing on the English, literature, the history of the English literature. I'm also talking about the theorist, which actually we are taking for our discourses, for our explanations, for our, research. So that is the main, aim of my chapter, sorry, my presentation. Yeah, I also remember that it's a Maharashtra Day also, as you told me the other day. So happy Maharashtra Day to all my Maharashtra, friends, as you told me the other
Sorry,
day.
ma'am.
You were telling me some,
Sorry.
it's a Maharashtra Day today.
Sorry. Yes.
So happy
Yes.
Maharashtra Day to all my, friends, those who are
Yes.
from Maharashtra.
Yeah. Thank you.
So
Thank you.
let me begin with my thing. I'll put on my now the most difficult part of the technology, that is to put my PPT. So I have to share screen, I think. And with
Yes.
that, this is my PPT. I think it's visible, is it? Is my PPT visible to all?
Not yet, ma'am. Yes,
Right, okay.
okay. Go ahead.
It's visible.
Yes.
Okay. So I have to make it, full now, because I think I'm missing something over here. I'll go with the slideshow because these are the things being a senior, I'm going to learn now
Yeah.
from people like you. How to make it full screen?
You have already learned a lot, ma'am.
Thank you so much. I'm trying, but I'm a basic, learner over there. How to make it full screen now? Please guide me.
You can click
Slideshow
down.
from the beginning. From the beginning, I
Yes.
have to do, I think.
No, it's
Why is
okay,
it?
ma'am.
Is it okay?
Yes.
Yes. So, my dear friends and my dear colleagues and my all senior faculty member, with due apology, I'm going to begin with the thing. I hope I'm quite audible to all and one. The very first,
Not there are certain comments that are not exactly audible.
okay.
Okay.
So, how to manage?
It's okay. You can now continue.
Is it okay now?
Yes.
Okay. Let me begin with my first, slide. This is literary journey of self. And the very first question I want to ask all my, people, those who are with me today, that do we have a true self or we are just imagining the things, I'm like that, I wanted to be like that, or how to actually search, ourselves. It's a quest for self. That is what, the whole life goes on when we have to deal with so many things. So in the introductory part, I would say, let me try to define self, which is a very, very difficult, thing. Self, is actually escaping into books about Middle Ages is my self-therapy. This is being said by Amber Sparks when she actually talked after the plague, era. So we can also in this, COVID era, we can say something like that. Although subjective experience is central to selfhood, the privacy of this experience is only one of the many problems. In the philosophical and scientific study of consciousness, the psychology of self is the study of either the cognitive and affective representation of one's identity or the subject of experience. The independent self is supposed to be egoistic, unique, and separated from the various contexts, critical in judgment, and prone to self-expression. Even Bernard Williams asserts, if there is one theme in all my work, it's about authenticity and self-expression. It is the idea that some things are in some real sense really you, or express what you and others aren't. Even Anthony Giddens says about literature, he said literature is often considered a form of expression used strategically by the author in a society riddled with conformist principles and a resounding sense of similitude. One must not only seek but portray the similarities and more often differences that make us unique. Shakespeare found his outlet of expression as a playwright. He captured the romantic idea of youth and the struggles they faced, much of humankind, and wrote plays people could relate to with his unmatchable passion and feeling that could nourish his soul. Psychiatrist Thomas says, people often say that this person or that person has not yet found himself, but the self is not something that one finds. It is something that one creates. Hence, creating literature transcends our feelings and thoughts at a symbolic and metaphoric level. Now, this article basically aims at the purpose of self-exploration for the life, and the goal is to make people think about the life they live in, to examine the past and the present, and thus to determine the better future. If we talk about, I have gone somewhere. Yes. The methodology, if we talk about the methodology, in this, you know, research, basically I have seen here in a traditional and a narrative, in a way, the secondary research sources, and self is looked for answering all the questions. What is self as a concept that has been looked from Eastern and Western philosophies, and basically literature related to, hello, am I audible? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Just a minute. There is some problem with my other, you know, laptop, because my matter is there. Actually, some light problem has not occurred. I'm so sorry. After methodology, I would like to talk about the objective of the study, where to say, basically, I'm going to search and analyze the spiritual and emotional expressions through literary text and in quest of identity through self-expression. In my next, you know, portion, I would like to see few reviews of the literature. And for that, I need my other computer to be opened up, because a few things I have written over here. Just bear with me, please. Basically, interpreter's relationship with the author could be seen, you know, from different angles, because we can look into the writers, the philosophers, and as well as the psychiatrists, you know, who are working in this, you know, field. So I have also taken few theories over here. And I would only like to tell one particular aspect of one particular, you know, person here. I think today my laptop is really disturbing me a lot. And because I don't have a printer at home, so I couldn't make a hard copy of the thing. So I'm caught up with this technology today very badly.
Not an issue, ma'am. Go ahead.
Just a minute, sir. I just need to open up my copy, the typed copy. Thank God it's there. I was scared. Okay. In this, you know, section, I would like to talk about George Bernard Shaw, you know, thing. Life isn't about finding yourself. Life is about creating you. The very first, you know, person I have taken is Augustine, who belonged to 354 AD. In his, you know, book, Confessions, he writes, there are three times, the present of things past in memory, the present of things present in direct perception, and the present of things future is expectations. And he keeps on in his book Confessions, which is his autobiography, he writes about the pear tree, you know, episode. He says he used to stole, you know, pears during his childhood, but when he was a mature, you know, man, he thought, I went away from you, my God, in my youth. I strayed too far from your sustaining power, and I became to myself a barren land. So this hypersensitive could be seen even in Mahatma Gandhi's autobiography and many others that might seem morbid by modern moral criteria, but in Augustine's own age, it seemed a mark of holiness. If you see the second, you know, our theorist, Montaigne, who in his book, The Complete Essays, he says, self-knowledge is the key to self-acceptance and feeling at home within the limits of our conditions. Descartes, on the other hand, in his book in 16th century, he says, I think, therefore I am. So this is very important aspect of self. John Locke, in his book, Theory of Mind, he says, who is also known as father of liberalism, that all our knowledge is the result of our experience and of reflection. He was the first to define the self through a continuity of consciousness. And at birth, his mind, he says, at birth, our mind is just a blank slate or tabula rasa learning through perception. My next person I have taken is Rousseau. In his Confessions, he also states that there are two attitudes which are possible towards the self, an innocent and inescapable love of self and a vicious and corrupt amour propre. The innocent emotions are limited to the individual, whereas self-conceit sought the favorable opinion of others in a never-ending, insatiable quest. It requires that others should prefer us to themselves, which is almost impossibility. And no one in the world knows me except myself. Now, this is the most important thing of his studies. Next is Goethe in his book, Poetry and Truth. He talks about the personality. He says, personality is everything in art and poetry. It is in self-limitation and a master shows himself. Tolstoy, in his book, autobiographical, you know, book, Childhood, Boyhood and Youth, he talks about life as a love. And he says life is love with three kinds, beautiful love, self-denying love and practical love. So beautiful love is affection and self-denying love is self-sacrifice and practical love is yearning too. James, the father of American psychology, in his book, Theory of the Self, he quotes, I know it was me who ate the cookie. Now, this was the sentence. I know it was me who ate the cookie. And he tried to give the reference to this sentence. He says, he called me as an empirical self and I as a pure ego. Even Herbert Mead, the writer in his book, Mind, Self and Society, he talks about the self as reflexive. He says it can be both subject and object, and there are many possibilities of consciousness. And Carl Rogers, one of the American psychotherapists, he talks about the ultimate stage, the achievement of a consistent fluidity and flexibility, and also self-actualization. He called the gap between real self and ideal self as incongruity. So after seeing all these theorists, I would like to move to Indian, you know, concept, the Indian philosophy. Indian philosophy in Sanskrit is known as darshanas, which refers to several traditions of philosophical schools originated from Indian subcontinent, especially including Hindu philosophy, Buddhist and Jainism. The main Hindu orthodox school of Indian philosophy is seen during the medieval period and which is being known as Brahmanic traditions. Vedas are the oldest, you know, texts with various, you know, schools. The very first school is Sankhya, which is a very orthodox school and which talks about the self and as a Purusha and Prakriti as a matter or energy. Second school is Yogic school by Patanjali in 2nd century BC. He talks about a calm mind and detachment to know about yourself, considering noble eightfold path of Buddhism also. The Nyaya school is the third one, which was in the 2nd century, which talks about the logic, knowledge, and inferences. Mimamsa talks about the liberation that can only be attained through the teaching of the Vedas. Vedanta, on the other hand, focuses on the philosophical teachings of the school, that is Upanishads. That means we have to do spiritual inspections within the Vedas only. The Buddhist philosophy talks about the bundle theorist. He says self is a bundle of insubstantial events or process. And in Bodhis teaching, Anant often is translated as no self, which is direct rejection of Upanishadic and Vedantic philosophy. While Jainism or Jain philosophy talks about the non-violence and the self-control to attain salvation of the soul. For them, that is the most important thing for a self. And there is another school, Indian epistemology, when we say the scientific school, which goes along with the Indian philosophy. It deals particularly with jnana and pramana. And there are different kinds of pramanas which are being used. They are the pratyaksha, that is perception, anumana, inference, upamana, comparison and analogy, arthapati, that is the postulation, abhav, that is the non-existence, shabda, the authority of the word, anupalabdhi is the achievement, and pratyaksha is the perception. So if you go with all these 18 paths, you can attain yourself to some extent according to epistemological school. So basically, they are also following Upanishadas, where self is portrayed as the underlying foundation of the cognitive capacities, according to Barua. After this, we'll come to the, this is regarding the Upanishad, where Barua is actually quoting. When we talk about the self-realization or self-exploration or self-representation, I think so many references are being seen in the literature from different, you know, angle. It's again on the interpreter, how the interpreter actually interpreted. Basically, the inner journey of the self in literature reaches the final destination, which is called self-realization, and the inner exploration helps a person to identify his true potential to achieve his goal in life. So human basically obsessed with emotions and feelings. These qualities rule over or dominate our human mind with our eyes of consciousness, and the ultimate goal of self-realization is to discover the fact that individual life and its relation to the world around them, which pushes them to live a life of virtue. The important concept of self-discovery is actually transformation. This is the basic idea that drives the journey of self-exploration, and it is wrapped with the notion of power, purpose, and integrity. The key concept, you know, which are being seen to identify the self, life, and world around us, can also be experienced in Shakespeare's in Hamlet, where he talks about the inner journey to gain power, and he's caught up within one, you know, thing, to be or not to be. And this is the thing, you know, we are often being caught in. Even the soliloquies which are being used in the drama in Hamlet, they also talk about the self-exploration of the various characters. Similarly, Charlotte Bronte's novel, Jane Eyre, or Shashi Deshpande's, you know, few novels like Dark, Cold, No Terror, they also talk about in a similar, you know, vein. Apparently, choosing ethical values and determined approach brings victory to the self, society, and the world. The different genres of literature play an important role in arousing the consciousness of the self. And the most important thing is the autobiographical self, because autobiographies or the biography, they are the major, you know, literary texts which talks about the self, and they basically try to give out the entity of a human being. Like Kim and Co, he quotes in 2007, we define self-expression as expressing one's thoughts and feelings, and these expressions can be accomplished through words, choices, or actions. Even Antonio describes various kind of neurological damage and uses them to identify a transient core self, and beyond it, the autobiographical self. Unlike the core self, which inheres as a protagonist of the primordial account, and unlike the proto self, which is a current representation of the state of the organism, the autobiographical self is based on a concept in the true cognitive and neurobiological sense of the term. The autobiographical self is based on autobiographical memory, which is constituted by implicit memories of multiple instances of individual experiences of the past and the anticipated futures. Even Herbert Mead also write in Mind, Self, and Society, there are all sorts of different selves answering to all sorts of different social reactions. Hence, the modern autobiographer is a prototype of the individualist self, as the writing subject becomes both author and hero of its own narrative. So memoirs are the first fully modern autobiography in English, while other scholars have explored the first emergence of the word autobiography as late as 1790s, together with the rapid proliferation of the genre around the time as an explicit version of the self-representation. And the first autobiography, sometimes people say it was the book of the Marjorie Kemp and so many others. And I think the very famous autobiographies are being given over here, like Babar's Babarnama. And you have Helen Keller's The Story of My Life. You have Annie Frank's The Diary of a Young Girl. Or you have M.K. Gandhi's My Experiments with Truth, and so many others. So when we go through the text, the English literary text, we can see our journey, you know, going through these, you know, periods. That is the old English period, Middle English period, the Renaissance, then the New Classical, and the Romantic period, the Victorian period, the Edwardian period, the Georgian, the Modern period, and the Postmodern period. And basically all these periods, they have their own, you know, virtues as well as the vices. Some good, you know, authors were also there, and few people, those who had given new trends here. So if we begin with the earlier, you know, period, like the Bunyan's, you know, The Pilgrim's Progress, which was the very first book in the Middle Ages, Allegory of the Person's Salvation, and The Guide to the Christian Life. Literature amplifies our sense of self, and in doing so makes it possible for us to live authentically, both in writing and in our spoken words. Philosopher of the first century AD, the Platonist Plutarch, in his treatise on tranquility of the first century, talks about that we should use our memory to weave the story of our life. In Orphism, Platonism, and the Pythagorean cult of ancient Greece, it was believed that the body holds the soul in bondage. This contribution focuses on the development of self-awareness and self-expression in antiquity and early medieval. Well, though it was a very oral, you know, time at that time, the morality and miracle, you know, time, but still people talk about the self and all. In the Shakespearean era, in the Elizabethan time, Shakespeare himself can be understood as the ultimate product of Renaissance humanism. He was an artist with a deep understanding of humanity and an uncanny ability of self-expression, who openly practiced and celebrated the ideals. Intellectual freedom. Many soliloquies depict his characters. There is one from Polonius, when Polonius, you know, says, okay, I haven't got it here. This above all, to thine own self be true, and it must follow as the night of the day. Thou canst not then be false to any man. Farewell, my blessing season, this in thy. So I think this is the way to empathize and with yourself, and to actually explore yourself in those, you know, things in which you are empathizing. And this was the trick, you know, which was being used by Shakespeare in most of his, you know, writings. The romantic concept of the self expresses a new concept of the self as a core. This is the romantic, the 18th century, the Industrial Revolution time. Literary romanticism forms part of the revolutionary epoch, and that has in a sense never ended, as for the aspirations of freedom, self-expression, and national identity are still erupting in the world. The lyric self, which emerged out of 18th century poetry and which has since become a paradigm of depersonal identity generally, was a specifically authorial self. From this perspective, eventually emerged the romantic self of 19th century lyric poetry, with its claims to autonomy, self-possession, and deep personal authenticity. Significantly, even Alexander Pope also matters in that, you know, age, when he talks about the model of Horace to construct his own, you know, identity. Even Wordsworth, Coleridge, they had come up with the lyrical ballads and all, and they do matter in that, you know, era, with so many other, you know, poets which had which were there. Even Ben Jonson had, you know, tried authority directly over his works, projecting, you know, his own, you know, self into that. In the age of Victorian era, the next, you know, era, that is actually generally keeping the practice of self-control, from emotional restraint to diligent work habits, and in the relationship between self-control, self-culture, and economic self-determination. It's a critical commonplace, well supported by popular 19th century advice, you know, literature. The 19th century was quite people, you know, those who were in the self, you know, control, they pretend to be into self-control, but we don't know how much. Through analysis of novels by Charles Dickens, Thomas Hardy, George Eliot, Samuel Butler, Alexander Bain, and so many others, like even Samuel Butler was also there. Their dissertations consider the parallel efforts of novelists and psychologists to reconcile this tension between highly valuing self-control and recognizing the physical and psychological obstacles to cultivating this control. So basically, it was for both the individuals and the species. And then comes the avant-garde time, that is the modernism. When we talk about the modernism, through some modernism emerged in the middle of the 19th century. And it actually began with in France with Charles Baudelaire in literature and Manet in painting, and perhaps with Gustave Flaubert in prose fiction. The avant-garde was what modernism was called at first. Sigmund Freud offered a view of subjective states involving an unconscious mind full of primal impulses and counterbalancing self-imposed restrictions, a view that Carl Jung would combine with a belief in natural essence to stipulate collective unconscious that was full of basic typologies that the conscious mind fought or embraced. Even Nietzsche, the Friedrich Nietzsche, one of the theorists, he championed a philosophy in which forces specifically the will to power, that is very important in the modernism, were more important than facts or things. Similarly, the writing of Henry Bergson championed the vital life force, which was also being used by Bernard Shaw and others, over static conception of reality. Leading lights within the literary wing of this trend included Joseph Conrad, T.S. Eliot, William Faulkner, Ezra Pound was there, Franz Kafka, W.B. Yeats, Virginia Woolf, Wallace Stevens, and so many others. The self may be an illusion in the modernism, at best an artifact in constant process of recreation. Even Immanuel Kant thought we must decide how it is right to act by the references to what a rational being would be, not a German, nor a man, or a woman. That would introduce bias, but just a rational being. Leading philosophers who have denied there is such a thing as self in the 20th century, including Wittgenstein, Elizabeth, Tony Kenny, and so many other theorists. Though they're quite difficult to understand, not very easy. However, writing and word determine fragile way of self-control as they're ended by death, as we say, the death of the author. In the works of Franz Kafka, death is particularly expressive, causing even renunciation of writing. The concept of Mikhail Bakhtin's polyphonic novel is also similar to the realm of the space of literature. That is, when we talk about, you know, multiple consciousness. So basically, modernism stands for rupture, revolution, innovation, defamiliarization, deconstruction, and so many things which fortifies actually the avant-garde. Then we come to the present era. This is the digital inner world. When we say Judith Glaser agrees on the importance of self-expression to be the first way to work effectively, for her, self-expression is not limited to speaking, writing, body language, or artistic endeavor. In the age of social media sites like Facebook, Twitter, and so on, we have found that social media may be seen as a valuable tool for expressing oneself for those with low self-esteem and or social anxiety. Even the popular songs are there, like you know, Express Yourself, Born This Way, something like, you know, these are very popular among the youngsters when we talk about, you know, the self-expressions and all. There are very popular, you know, books which are being, you know, seen on the Amazon. When you search for the book, you know, you want to read on self-expression and all. I think these are the books like Mind, Morals and the Meaning, Creating Mandalas, or maybe Mastering the Art of Self-Expression. After this, basically, going through all these periodical, you know, hub, I think the culture is the main, you know, thing which do matters into the construction of the self. Language, which is a mirror to our world, it captures and reflects some of the deepest human emotions, if we see culturally. Generally speaking, psychologically finding support, the idea of the self-expression that affects people in positive ways. We define self-expression as expressing one's thoughts and feeling, and these expressions can be accomplished through words, choices, actions, society, as well as the region, you know, to which belong. And that's why so many literature these days are so popular, like native literature, Aboriginal literature, Dalit literature. He stated that society corrupted this innate goodness and free will of individuals and oppressed their self-expression Through self-integrity and self-reliance, individuals strive to attain happiness and freedom, and self-expression empowers the individual. So that's why now, you know, different Caribbean literature is also coming into the scene. In the cultural traditions, some even Descartes has to say, he says, I think, therefore I am. Self-expression reflects the desire for individuals to negotiate the self in a social world. The promise of cultural psychology lies in understanding the complexity of this negotiation and the values and beliefs that shape it. And here I would like to quote, you know, Mary Oliver's in a poem, Journey, where she says, the stars began to burn through the sheets of clouds, and there was a new voice which is slowly recognized as your own. So this is the, what, you know, the cultural voice which comes into the construction of a self. If you see the psychological, you know, perspective from Bruner's, in a point, who is a psychotherapist, basically, so psychology is most eloquent advocate of the narrative mode in a remembered self implies the crucial cognitive activities involved in self-construction. We see much more like thinking than memory. Means in memories do make our, you know, self. It's not only just thinking. It is a famous difference between seeing the glass as half empty and seeing it as half full. So this is the psychological, you know, perspective, whether you wanted to be optimistic or not. It is better to be an optimist. Everybody loves an optimist. Everybody wants to be enthusiastic. As Kinger also says in the beginning of the play, nothing will come of nothing. Speak again. That is being, you know, ordered to Cordelia. He's one of the daughter. So to express ourselves, we need to say something. Delphic Oracle's guidance was, quote, know thyself. Means you know yourself, you know. Today in the world of social networking, the Oracle's advice might be show thyself, because now we are into the digital world. So where we are heading? We are heading from know thyself to show thyself. But I think after this COVID, you know, thing, which had come into the scene, I'm again, you know, looking that now human being must be going from show thyself to know thyself. And that is the only way to actually preserve our nature to have sustainable development in the world. Even the great poet Maya Angelou warns, there is no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside you. So let the self come out. Let our expressions, you know, come out. And one particular thing which I was talking when we talked about the review of the literature, I also talked about the self-reflexivity. This is very, very important. Sometimes self-identity is not a distinctive, you know, trait or even a collection of traits possessed by the individual. It is the self as reflexively understood by the person in terms of his or her biography. Reflexive modernization helps as a result of the existing social order scrutinizing itself and in particular its limitations and anomalies. It is the typical of postmodern literature. There is consensus that it dates back to the 18th century and that it can be found in Lawrence Sterne's Tristram Shandy. I think that was the first book, you know, which actually looked back towards the self. As a 9-volume novel published between 1759 and 1766, there are so many other you know, works are also there which were really challenging, and it was something like a genesis, you know, which Pryde, you know, says that man stands apart from all other, you know, animals, but still that animal instinct, you know, lies over there. And Lawrence Provine also quotes over here, basic to this uniqueness is the awareness of this sense of self and movement towards this self-actualization. Because why we go with the self-reflexivity? Because we wanted to have the actualization of the present scenario. There is Hume and Berkeley, they also favor the bundle theory of the personal identities, where your experiences are bundled together, and then with the memory, you know, concept, you bring them back into your writing. Then let's talk about few narratives here, because the fiction, short stories, they're very important. By reading, writing, and practicing the art, the superior man could elevate himself and give rise to virtuous self-expression. Not surprisingly, the implementation of different strategies of identity often moves to the space of literature as expansion of the human being in the world. The concept of Mikhail Bakhtin's polyphonic novel is similar to the realm of the space of literature. The long 18th century is a period in which these two models of the self here bluntly dichotomized coexist in a not easily resolved tension as exists between, say, the novels of Fielding and Richardson, or according to some accounts, in which the former gives way to the latter, giving a crucial phase in the establishing of modern sense of things. So now in the modernity, when we talk about the narration, it's a self-assertion. You know, we try to assert ourselves into those, you know, texts. Self-assertion is an inherited or innate psychophysical disposition. Poetry, prose, fiction, dialogue, they employ language to evoke and exalt special qualities of self, life, and suffice readers with feelings. It is particularly lyric poetry, which is based on feelings and provides still another emotional benefit. So all identity and moral action depends on narrative, according to this view, but the individual itself can be distinguished from other forms of identity. And in that, it functions specifically as the originator, creator, or author of its own narrative. In Masher's words, quote, by acting as author, the individualist self becomes its own telos. It constitutes a beginning and an end in itself. And if you read Doris Lessing's, you know, book, I think you're going to have it, the thing over here, this, you know, feeling. Almost a century ago, a young genetist, Haldane, he made a series of startling predictions in one of his little book, that is Daedalus or Science and the Future. I wanted to give example of this book. Now, this book actually talked about the genetic modifications. It talked about the ectogenesis. It was a science, you know, fiction. And this book, you know, when actually read by the other, you know, people, it caused so many different, you know, expressions on the people, impressions on the people. The interpretations were so different. The understandings were actually were so curious. Bertrand Russell, you know, when he read that, you know, book, he thought about the future of science and he called it Icarus. Aimed at educated readers rather than a mass market, they still had a profound impact, this book. And when Aldous Huxley, he read the book, he wrote a book after reading this book, The Utopia, and also The Brave New World. And very surprisingly, when Churchill read this book, he wrote an essay. And the essay titled, Shall We All Commit Suicide? Means when he read about the science in a scientific, you know, world, which is going to come in the coming in a future. So this was the essay, you know, which, so that shows how narratives, no doubt, they really add to yourself. Richard Sonnet, in The Fall of the Public Man, in The Making of the Modern Self, speak of an ancient regime based on the performative role-based view of the self. Even Charles Taylor says the same, you know, thing. And moreover, short fictions, like all other types of literature, makes contributions to the development of cognitive analytic abilities by bringing the whole self to bear on a compressed account of a situation in a single place and moment. So that's why we find all short stories, maybe Panchatantra and others, they really actually are very, very impressive to teach our, you know, selves, or to teach ourselves, or to teach the other. The use of drama seems to be an effective technique in today's communication-based world. Since drama is the reenactment of social events, students improve their personality and code of behavior through that. Thus, they can achieve more meaningful and realistic teaching to raise their consciousness. If selected carefully, novel is a very effective way of building one's inner self with the exterior world. Even the novels, the drama, they do also help into all these, you know, things. That's why I think cinema, theater is going a long way with youngsters as well as all age groups. Even Indian English literature is not far behind with all these things. We could come across the East-West conflict, the multiculturalism, the social realism, the gender issues, and so many other things with the ecological concerns, the magic realism, the self-expressions were also there. And like Sri Aurobindo's, you know, poetry, you could read and you could come across the self-expression, you know, motive of the things. Even Salman Rushdie, when he wrote his famous, you know, book, his Midnight's, you know, Children, we saw there a fusion of religion, fantasy, mythology, which has actually created a complex, you know, reality and personality of the author. Even the Narayan's very simplest, you know, book, The Guide, which is being read by all. Actually, even in that, you know, book, you would come across the characters are heading towards these self-discoveries. And they also depict all kind of, you know, modern values. Even Wolf Rana, who is considered as the first and the, one of the modern, you know, Indian author, here people say that one of the critic, you know, Mehta, I quote, the tremendous moral courage is shown by Anand to forefront the ferocious caste system, Bankim's romanticism, Tagore's humanizing breath, Premchand's sympathy for the suffering people, and Sharad Chandra's understanding of the human arts has already influenced the artistic makeup of Mulkraj Anand. So see how the text, they influence the character building, the self-making of the authors too. Here I would like to quote Steve Miller. He says, for all the writers actually, those who are actually improving their expressions into their writing, they must remember this: I want to fly like an eagle. Let my spirit carry me. I want to fly like an eagle till I'm free. But you can never be free. Huh, sometimes writers feel they are free when they jot down things, something on their paper. The most important thing in the self-expression is actually the poetry. During the early 19th century, the most sought-after form of self-expression was poetry. The goal of poetry therapy was actually to develop accuracy and understanding in perceiving self and others, and to develop creativity, self-expression, and greater self-esteem. Three important poets who are typically associated with the confessional poetry, because that was very, very important part of expressing yourself. They were Annie Sexton and Sylvia Plath, and so many others. In literature, Romanticism was to some extent a reaction against the strict rules which was being formulated by the neoclassicists. And we had seen so many beautiful, you know, poems and during that, you know, era, especially written by Wordsworth, Coleridge, John Keats, Byron, and so many others. Even the Victorian poetry of Tennyson, Browning, Longfellow in the modern, you know, era, sorry, Longfellow and Whitman from the American, you know, context, Emily Dickinson, one of the famous, you know, poetess, they had actually shaped the course of the 19th century American poetry. And in India, Aurobindo and Tagore can't be actually ignored. Even if we see the ancient Indian, you know, literature, we would come across the poetic, you know, literature, especially in Vyasa, Valmiki, Kalidasa, Bhabhuti, you know, or Tulsidas or Chandi. They were all the poets, you know, who had really expressed their cultural, you know, self, their emotional self, their psychological self, as well as, you know, the artistic, you know, self which was with them. So here I would like to see few, you know, samples. If you wish, you can see them. There is a poem, you know, Tintin Abbey, which is being written by Wordsworth, where he's trying to sympathize with the river, and he says in his writing, how often in spirit have I turned to thy, O Sylvan, why? Similarly, there is a poem, I Am, which is being written by John Clare. But the interesting thing is, this poem was written by him when he was in a lunatic asylum. Even as a mad fellow, he writes, I am, yet what I am none cares or knows. My friends forsake me like a memory lost. I'm the self-consumer of my woes. They rise and vanish in oblivious host, like shadows in love's frenzied stifled throes. And yet I am and live. I mean, I have to live. That is the main, you know, thing of the poem. Who doesn't know a song of myself? Walt Whitman's in a poem where he says, I celebrate myself and sing myself. And what I assume, you shall assume, for every atom belonging to me, as good belongs to you. Invectus, one of the poems which was even being, you know, sung by Mandela also, he says, my head is bloody but unbowed. I'm the master of my fate. I'm the captain of my soul. And this should be our, you know, self according to the authors. Then if you see the romantic, you know, theory, self and nature, they are the same. The self-awareness, which is a selfish, you know, dead end, but a mode of knowledge, opening up the universe with self-realization, self-expression, self-reliance, you know, so many self-assertion, all these things could be seen in various literary works. Now, as a woman, I would like to have a glimpse towards the women literature also, because women literature is not too, you know, old. Throughout the centuries, men have overshadowed women in all genres in writing and arts. Listening to the sounds of silence, this is what now we say, to what the text does not or cannot explicitly say, can bring us closer to understanding what writing may have meant for medieval women. And what of the Inui conspicuous in Murasaki Shikibu's diary or Shu Shonagon's pillow book? They are the Japanese, you know, authors, first authors. They also write about the life at court and which they have earned because of their literary company. They were quite well-read in women, but still they couldn't, you know, get that much of publicity as the men authors were being, you know, given. Nowhere is the danger attendant on writing a self-expression for medieval women more dramatically and tragically evident in the case of Margaret Poret, a 14th century mystic. This is very strange. She was just as a heretic, and she and her book, The Mirror of Simple Souls, that was the first book she wrote, she was burned together at that with her, you know, book at the stake, because earlier women could not express herself because she would most likely have been illiterate according to the people. But that doesn't mean that women actually had not, you know, come so far. Women ranging widely across centuries, countries and genres, from Dora in 19th century France to Shi Shonagan, Murasaki Shikibu in the 10th century Japan, Christina Pisan in the 15th century, they have started writing with manuals or the conduct, you know, for adolescents or diaries they were writing. The first novels, you know, deportment books in the form of the deportment books were being, you know, written. And they also helped to constitute and reconstitute their sense of selfhood. And the most important name is the Virginia Woolf. Virginia Woolf is thought by many as one of the foremost figures of the modernist movement in literature who explored her own understanding of the individual's navigation through personal space. She has acute awareness of the world outside her window that gave her both borders for great literary success and an anarchic lens through which to view human experience. And she writes, "With decent grace, we have not yet done at all, nor we do it. Bring your statue. You have room." So that room for a woman matters along. Annie Chung in one of her book, Unveiling India, talks about the Indian complexity. She says, in the complex pantheon of diversity, the Indian woman remains a point of unity, unveiling through each single experience of collective unconscious prized by society that is looked in mortal combat with the power and weakness of age and time. She remains the still center, like the center of the potter's wheel, circling to create new forms, unfolding the continuity of racial life, which in turn has enriched and helped her to acquire a quality of concentration. This concentration can be actually taken into consideration to self-expression from the women. And they write up about the glimpses of the unexplored female psyche, which has no accessibility. The majority of these writers, they are actually having this quote from Virginia Woolf, which is there. And if we see some few, you know, feminine musical, you know, things from, I literally love this one. Dorothy's Life says, you know, one of the eminent Canadian poet, he says how a woman, you know, tries to search herself in the household, you know, scenario. Reader, if you are curious to find in this book my proper self, warning, I like the pepper pot, live each day on a different shelf. The metaphor implied by her in one of her in a poem and in a book, you know, The Self-Completing Tree, is a tree. And with that in a tree, she talks about the ecofeminism in a modern, you know, way, where she says, my body is tree, my reaching boss and tukes are skeleton meant to be. This will I willingly submit to die, my skeleton, my tree. Even Emily Dickinson's, you know, poem, very, very important to read, which actually echoes the self-assertion, self-expression, and some confessions are also there. And who doesn't know this great, you know, poetess, Maya Angelou, the Afro-American, you know, poet, who has written the poem Still I Rise, which was being read by Barack Obama also. And she was invited, you know, when he had taken an oath. And I'm going to read the last part of that in a poem. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise into a daybreak that is wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. And I think with this mantra, all the women, they are striving their best to self, striving their best, you know, actually to get through the self into their writing. Now let me come to the last slide of my presentation. And with this, I wanted to see now East versus West. What are the Eastern perspective and what is the Western thing? Any Western-centric theory of self-expression will likely propose that a good dose of self-expression is not only healthy, but necessary for fulfillment. Means in West, you know, self-expression is a must. On the other hand, a theory from an Asian or Middle Eastern country will likely take place little importance on individual self-expression and may even see it as a deviant behavior. But in our Eastern, you know, thing, we say it's a wrong thing. It's an egoist, you know, thing, expressing yourself. So the journey of self-discovery is the most important journey we are actually taking today. According to the Hindu religious text Vedanta, we all have personal likes and dislikes, fond memories and plans for the future. But to bring them into our, you know, self and to actually explore ourselves, we must always remember a few, you know, things, that is the existence of the soul, our subtle body, the symptoms of the soul, the proper use of our independence, our constitutional positions, And with this, I think, from the Indian point of view, one can see the God as a supreme, you know, being. Sometimes we also call him, you know, Shri Krishna. He is the source of everything, and that includes all loving, you know, relationship, which gives you that strength to search for yourself. Western philosopher Plato and his school distinguished matter from idea and soma from psyche. In the 20th century, however, an area of psychobiological monistic attitudes arose in the Western tradition, basically idealistic, reinforced by Judeo-Christian beliefs. Philosophical and anti-dualism in China can be traced to Confucius and even earlier. The rationalist theory, which Immanuel Kant has inspired, also claims that our ability to achieve self-knowledge through rational reflection is partly derived from the fact from the fact that we view ourselves as rational agents. For Socrates, the goal of philosophy was to know thyself. For the Chinese philosopher, it was knowing others is wisdom. Knowing the self is enlightenment. And even from the Upanishadic, you know, point of view, we say the ultimate knowledge is understanding the essence of ourself. Even Adi Shankaracharya in his commentary on Bhagavad Gita says, self-knowledge alone eradicates misery. So self-knowledge alone is the means of the highest bliss. Absolute perfection is the consummation of self-knowledge. Self-expression is really concerned with conveying belief towards others, and rather about a personal journey towards self-definition. It is about a discovery. It is linked with the concept of self-awareness and self-conception. The journey of self-discovery is a popular theme in literature. It is sometimes used to derive the plot of a novel, play, or film. And if you ask the people all around you, I think they would talk about all these things. This I got from the internet. They talk about this in literature. When I was talking to my friends on this, they say, oh, we have seen the book, you know, Hermann Hesse's Siddhartha, or we have also gone through the Life of Pi, we have gone through the Lovely Bones, the Habibi and all. They also talk about few movies, you know, which you can see to see how the self goes on, like The Holy Mountain or The Life of Pi, The Tree of Life. I think these are the utopians movies also there. So these are the movies, you know, which are being often discussed in the circle in the present in the scenario. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation with the words of John Shu, who says, good things will come from self-expression. And we shouldn't forget in our literature, because Wayne Dyer says, keep on writing something. And he says, don't die with the music still in you. Listen to your intuitive inner voice and find what passion stirs your soul. So it's not literature. You can express yourself through other means also. Thank you so much. Thank you, Prashant. And thank you to all my lovely friends who are with me.
Thank you, ma'am. There are certain questions for you.
Okay.
There are a few. There is self is non-exist entity.
Okay.
As per the canon of New Criticism, how do you view it in the context of your presentation?
Actually, I had tried to see self as a non-existent also, because when we see the Eastern, you know, thing, or when we see the Middle Eastern, you know, things, I think there in Middle Eastern countries also, if you read the literature, people say, you know, something like that. Why do you want to search self? You can ask your family, they're going to tell you about you. So that becomes very physical, you know, entity of the things. So now it's up to us, you know, whether we wanted to look inwards or we wanted to look outward. If you wanted to look, it's a non-existent thing. You know, death of the other, when they say you have to interpret at your own. But we say inwards, you know, there is something within us. Maybe at our strengths, even our weaknesses, they might be our, you know, self. We can improve, we can work on them. So it's a thing, you know, again, on the way how you interpret the things. I hope I have satisfied the person.
Yes, yes. One more.
Yes.
By Dr. Sangeeta Ghodke, ma'am.
Okay.
What is collective unconsciousness and what role does it play in understanding self?
I think collective consciousness is a modified part of the stream of consciousness. When we had seen, you know, the narratives during the 18th and 19th century, we have seen novels, short stories coming into the scene. And we have seen the books like I, you know, talk self flexibly in my, you know, presentation where I talked about Tristram Shandy or maybe Dawn Osborne's books back in Anger, in all those, you know, books, or maybe The Sound and the Fury. You know, these books actually, they talked about that, you know, conscious, you know, perspective. Because when you are, as a narration, you are narrating, or as a writer, you are writing, you are going along with one particular consciousness. Even the Slumdog Millionaire, if you go over there, there is a collective, you know, consciousness, which is happening even in the movie. So that's why sometimes you find those, you know, novels or those, you know, short stories very, very difficult to understand. And that is the latest trend which has, you know, occurred in the our, you know, creative, you know, world. Because basically, we can't actually control our consciousness or our, you know, mind to one particular strain. So many things are going on like waves in our mind. So sometimes people do give words to them. So a collective consciousness brings in a beautiful, you know, creativity. Sometimes, and sometimes maybe chaotic, you know, thing like Tristram Shandy, or maybe, you know, Waiting for Godot sort of, you know, books, it might, you know, come into the scene.
Yes. Hello.
Hello.
Yes. There is one more question. How can we incorporate this theory of self in the modern age of digitalization?
I think I had already talked in one of my, you know, slides. Digital world is really difficult because digital world had actually stopped us from imagining things. We are visualizing everything. So nowadays people are more concerned about the Facebook, the Twitter, the Insta. The youngsters are concerned about the TikTok. You know, very strangely, and very, I'm really sad to know that I think last week only I heard in news that one of the youngster, he actually did suicide. Why? Because he couldn't get the number of, you know, best, you know, comments on his TikTok, you know, video. So that was, you know, showing yourself. And basically in the digital world, people want to show their self. For that, you know, they keep on posting beautiful, you know, photographs, beautiful, you know, things on the Facebook. They might be, there are so many jokes, you know, at home, people are, you know, talking very rudely, but when they are on the Facebook, they talk so politely. And they're not with their real, you know, self. And even there was a she moment which had, you know, gone that come without, you know, makeup on the screen, come without makeup with your, you know, photograph. That is, you know, actually showing your true self. So this is what the beginning of my presentation. Okay, whether are we really true to ourselves or not? So in the digital world, self has become a thing of a display. So I think instead of making self as show thyself, let's now move inwards and know ourselves or know thyself. That should be taken in the digital world. Though it's very, very difficult because we are so engrossed and so tempted with the digital world that we believe, you know, that world more, the virtual world, you know, more than the real world. And I think these things are happening in homes also. Our youngsters, our people at home, they are busy with their virtual friends rather than caring for the people, you know, those who are sitting besides them. So that is a strange thing, but still we need to do a thing. If the simplicity comes into the scene naturally, the show off, you know, goes on, then we can actually work inwards and we can know ourselves. Thank you.
Are you there, LG Patil sir? Hello. Are you there, LG Patil sir?
Hello.
Wait a minute, ma'am.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you listen to me?
Yes, I can.
Yes.
Ma'am, how would you react to Eliot's theory of impersonality?
Eliot's theory of impersonality.
Yes.
You know, in traditional individual talent, he writes about that, you know, theory, and he says actually personality of the author should not reflect into the work. That is what it actually, the whole crux of the theory, though it is a very difficult, you know, theory to understand, as per Eliot's, you know, books are too difficult to understand. But when we talk about the impersonality of the technique, I think the latest thing has come, the death of the author, where we find that in postmodern context, the author must not be seen into a book. Means the author should not actually, or must not actually express himself into his writing. He must be very, very objective. And as soon as the text is over, there must be the death of the author. The personality is gone. He must be an impersonal, you know, thing for that, you know, text. And that text itself becomes an individual. So even when an author reads that, you know, book again, I think he will read it from a different, you know, perspective, forgetting his own personality. Because if he remembers his personality, this is my book, I have written it, you know, that comes into that, you know, ego perspective. And he might only see one particular side of the coin of that particular creative, you know, text. But if he sees it in an impersonal, you know, tone, I think he can see the other side, the objective side of the text also. And sometimes we have seen authors, they come with so many reviews of their text. You know, so many, the best authors like Walt Whitman, Leaves of Grass. See how many editions he has, you know, brought into that, because that was the impersonality of the character. I hope, sir, it means something to you.
Okay, there is one interesting question.
Okay.
Do you think that COVID-19 outbreak will change our perception of the self?
I think if we would be into such kind of in a quarantine, you know, period for longer, if there is no, if we are unable to actually lock it down thoroughly with the proper vaccine and medicine, and the time spans moves longer and longer, definitely the people, those who are living at home, they will have to think about their, you know, self. Otherwise, as the news are coming in, we are watching into that, so much of domestic violence is going on, so much of harassment is going on, people are so depressed, people are so oppressed, so many calls, you know, stress calls are coming out. I think people need to actually look into the know thyself. Because if we'll try to look into ourselves, we find, okay, home is the best place. Why to be worried about, going out? The best place where you could actually create so many things. No, you have to have some hobby, you have to have some, you know, creativity, you have to have your, you know, passionate soul to be kept somewhere in your home. In that case, you can earn, you know, more into yourself, rather than actually thinking in a negative, you know, way. This is what, you know, in one of my slides I talked about, that optimism, you know, perspective, that if there is a glass, you know, half filled with water, now it's up to you how you want to see it. It's a half filled, or, you know, how optimally, how optimistically you can see that, you know, glass, that is up to you. So if this COVID, you know, stress which is there, because this is our lifetime, you know, experience, and we can imagine if we go to the historical, you know, into the history of the literature, we could come across the plague, you know, time, the deaths, you know, time, the Spanish flu time, you know, we had seen so many deaths, so many even civilizations has been, you know, lost. So at this, you know, era, I think people would start definitely thinking about what is a human being, how to go for the sustainable development, how to actually go along with the environment. And if you are able to consider yourself one of the entity of the environment, I think you have seen yourself. But if you have that ego of being a human being who could control the environment, then you have not seen yourself. So I think COVID is going to teach us this thing, sustainable development, and to protect our environment and nature. Thank you so much.
Beyond this literary theory of self, what is the situation at Shimla?
Shimla is quite free from COVID at the present, you know, moment. Everything is locked down, curfew is still there. Though Shimlites are quite sensible, you know, people, and we are giving our full support to whatever is being, you know, required. We are all inside our homes. Things are very cool. Weather is good. And I hope we are going to win the war, at least from the Shimla point of view, I would say.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Anita Sharma, ma'am, for your fruitful, delightful, comprehensive and highly informative session. With your lucid language, you clearly explained literary journey of self. Thank you very much, one and all, for your active participation by logging Zoom, and those who are watching on YouTube channel, and made this lecture series a grand success. There are certain questions from the participants we are giving as far as the certificate is concerned. we are giving unique certificate to each and every participants, but participants need to fill the Google form and send this Zoom participation screenshot or YouTube channel Langlet Educators subscription screenshot where you have watched all these videos to the email ID elanglitmotivators@gmail.com. Our designer is working on the certificate. Very soon you will receive the Google form link. We are not generating certificates by Google Forms. We are working on the certificates manually. That's why it takes time. You need to approach me through mail or through my mobile number after 7th May. You can also visit the website www.langlet.org. Kindly keep in touch. Don't forget to subscribe the channel so that you will get further notifications. Log in at 6 p.m. for two interesting topics. First is using technology to teach English grammar, and second, analyzing text in the contemporary context, a practical approach. So let's share knowledge and grow together. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Prashant.
Thank you, Prashant.
Your Langlet, and all the best to you and Langlet. And I think Langlet is a wonderful, journal which has really motivated me to write the papers as well as the other, creative, things. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your contribution and for your academic support. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.